Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for being here this evening, joining us for this very important and long-awaited meeting of the Higher Purpose Forum. Our speakers, Jeffrey and Christine, have been working on this content for quite a while, and it's a very, very important part of the sequence that we've been developing for 4 years now on the issues of race in the American Providence. And this is sort of a concluding chapter of that series. So we're very eager to share it. And thank you for being in our audience. Everything that we develop and present in the Higher Purpose Forum, it goes into content that we're developing for public dissemination. And some of our content that was first presented in this forum is now being taught publicly, particularly our content on race and providence in America. So this is part of our core curriculum today. And before we start the program, we're very happy the Higher Purpose Forum is actually honored that our events are now being co-hosted by HJ International Graduate School of Peace and Public Leadership. It's added a great deal of depth and exposure to this forum. And I'd like to introduce one of the deans, Dean Boyd of HJI, who will welcome us to this evening's meeting.
Well, thank you very much, Jim. It's a pleasure to be here. My name is Stephen Boyd, and I'm the Dean of Enrollment Management and Student Life at HJI. As Jim explained, HJI is really pleased to be able to co-sponsor this event along with several other important topics that we've shared together in this forum. We welcome you. We're glad that you're here. And we invite you, if you are interested, to learn more about HJ International Graduate School for Peace and Public Leadership. We have several programs of study, and you might be interested just in taking one or two courses to get a taste of what it's like at our graduate school. Many of our Unifications members are doing that right now. So to that end, I'm going to be putting my contact information and a couple of links about details about programs of study and how to apply into the chat box later in the program. So thank you all for coming. It's a pleasure to welcome you. And I'll hand it back to Jim.
Thank you, Dean Boyd. I'm now a doctoral student at HJ International Graduate School, and it's been a great experience being back in the classroom and learning things that I didn't realize how much I didn't know until I started studying there 4 semesters ago. All right, well, here's our program for today. Is my screen visible?
Mm-hmm.
All right. We're very pleased, again, that our presentation today by Jeffrey Kingsley and Christine Edwards is titled God's Dream, Building a Racially Integrated Society. And this is part one of a two-part series. So this should say God's Dream, Building a Racially Integrated Society, part one. They'll be presenting their content. And hopefully, Reverend Oliver will be able to join us. Reverend Oliver is actually in Zambia right now, so he's 6 or 7 hours ahead of us, which means it's the middle of the night for him. And I'm very grateful for Reverend Oliver to join us tonight. But more importantly, Reverend Oliver has been a very important supporter and contributor to this very series on race and providence from the very, very beginning 4 years ago. So it's really sort of important to us to have him continuing to participate in this a conversation on the core topic for Higher Purpose Forum. And then after Reverend Oliver provides his response, we'll have a moderated discussion, and we'll go over the rules of the road for that right now. Oh, what did I do? Sorry about that. All right. So please be aware that today's participants represent a range of faiths and perspectives. We're not all part of one spiritual group, but multiple groups, which is what we're hoping for here. Let's make sure that everyone feels welcome and included in our conversation and feels they can be fully participate. Our discussion period is an important part of our program. Our discussion period is likely to begin at about 8:05. And so it lasts for at least 20. The meeting will end at 8:30, but the discussion will start no later than 8:05. So we'll have at least 25 minutes for our discussion. And it's very common that the most exciting part of our meetings is the discussion. A lot of interesting perspectives can be contributed during those 25 minutes. So we are hoping for your participation. And there's two ways to participate in the discussion period. Either use the Zoom raise hand function so that the moderator, that's me tonight, can call on you, or simply place your comment or question in the chat in an everyone pane, which is easy to find, where it will be handled by our chat moderator. And the chat moderator tonight is Dean Boyd, and he'll enter those he has time for and fit well into our conversation. He'll enter those into the meeting, either your comments or your questions. We look forward to seeing those in the chat box. This meeting is being recorded, and at some point we hope to post it on our website. It will also be available through HJI on their website, and we will end no later than 6:30. 8:30. 8:30. Okay. I just want to quickly say that Higher Purpose Forum is a 501c3, was founded in September of 2019. It's an independent project of unificationism. We have been developing specific topic areas. The central one is what we're covering tonight, which is under race and providence in America, which we describe as a unificationist worldview. And we're eager to present that content to your community in your town. Contacts who are happy to present it. I've been presenting it regularly in recent weeks. And there's four areas of counter-proposal. One is the topic we're discussing tonight, understanding how God intends to build a racially integrated culture. Secondly is justice and economic democracy, and we're developing that with IAED. Our third core topic area is the unity of science, spirituality, and religion. And a fourth area we want to begin developing hopefully soon is the idea of the God-centered three-generation family. And I'm very happy to announce that we're also, Higher Purpose Forum is also starting public meetings. We're having a meeting on Sunday afternoon in Boston, our first one. The title of that is U.S. Immigration Policy, A Practical and Ethical Examination, and it's being presented by Mr. Sun Young Miller. Very quickly, I'd like to just share some of the upcoming events before we start our presentation tonight. Most importantly, on Thursday, the 11th of April through Saturday, the 13th of April, Asia International Graduate School will present its first conference on peace and public leadership. So HJI International is no longer a seminary narrowly focused on issues of ministry. It's now a full-fledged graduate school. And the agenda for this conference reflects the diversity of areas which are covered and studied at the graduate school. There's, I think, nine sessions, and Higher Purpose Forum has been invited to present session seven, which is on Friday night from 8 to 9:30. And our topic is economic democracy, an essential component of positive peace. And we have four very interesting speakers, including a couple real heavyweights, Robert Ashford from Syracuse University and Norm Curlin, who's sort of one of the fathers of the ideas of binary economics, as well as Don Brohan, who is the co-director of their organization, CESJ. And the introduction will be given by Alan Jessen. And then we have a three-part series on the unity of science, spirituality, and religion. The first two parts will be presented on April 23rd and May 7th by Dr. Wilson of HJI Graduate School. And then the third session on May 22nd will be taught by Allison Wakelin, who's on the faculty of Widener University. So I hope that you'll be able to join the first International Conference on Peace and Public Leadership. I will be sending out probably tomorrow or the next day the registration information to all the subscribers in our database. So you'll be receiving an invitation electronically to this important conference. And again, our session is session 7 of 8 on economic democracy. All right. Thanks for bearing with me as I go through those announcements. I'd just like to briefly introduce our two speakers today. Firstly, Jeffrey Kingsley. After graduating with a BA in economics from Rutgers University, Jeffrey worked as a public policy analyst for the New Jersey Governor's Office. He subsequently matriculated at Princeton University in the public policy graduate program. Jeff joined CARP, which is a student ministry, in 1980 and was involved in campus ministry for the next 7 years. He earned his Master's of Divinity degree from the Unification Theological Seminary in 1990 and returned to campus ministry work at the campus at Princeton University. Subsequently, he developed an ESL tutoring business for immigrant Japanese and Korean businessmen and then taught ESL in public schools for 26 years. Currently, Jeffrey does private SAT tutoring and is an advisor and content creator for this project, the Higher Purpose Forum. His passion and activism throughout his life has always been to promote the complementarity between races, religions, and political ideologies. And he grew up in Princeton, New Jersey, and his middle school classmate was our next speaker, Christine Edwards. They actually went to school together, middle school together. And that, as I understand, they worked in the library together. Christine is the daughter of an Afro-American father and a Swiss-German mother. Her paternal grandfather was a minister in the AME Church and her maternal granduncle, a minister in the Church of Zwingli. She obtained her BFA in Fine Arts from SUNY in Purchase, New York, and an MRE at the Unification Theological Seminary in 1984. Christine volunteered with CARP Campus Ministry in New York and in Germany. She also worked at the New York City Tribune and the Mount Manhattan Center and did contract work for the Professors World Peace Academy. Growing up in a multiracial family based in both the United States and Europe has profoundly shaped Christine's perspective, which she brings to all of her endeavors. So there's an introduction to our well-prepared speakers, childhood friends, and I'd like now to turn the program over to Jeffrey, who will begin the first part of the presentation, and then Christine will present the second part of the presentation, followed by our respondent. Thank you, Jeffrey.
All right. Thank you very much, Jim. And I assume, so let me begin. Okay, so God's dream. How do we express that in a few words? Well, we know that God's dream is that we recognize that we're all children of God, and thereby we're all one family, brothers and sisters. And that leads to tonight's topic, which is God's dream, building a racially integrated culture. Before we get into the meat of the matter, our story a little bit, you've heard a little bit from Christine and my story, and we graduated from the same high school class, and then recently I found this picture from a middle school yearbook I had in my papers. I'm on the left there, Christine's on the right, so we do go way back, and those are pictures from our eighth grade class, I believe. Looks a lot like us now, right, Christine? So, you know, it's kind of like Christine, you know, our paths have crossed many times, although we've never worked together, right? Exactly, Christine, until now. So what, some 40 years later?
Yeah.
50 years later, actually. We had the opportunity to work on this project together. It almost seems a little bit like destiny that this came together, and we're excited about presenting to you guys tonight. So what is America's providential role in fulfilling God's dream of one family? Well, let's look at first the words of our founder, Father Moon. He said that the key to the continuing prosperity of the cultures is harmony. But a harmonizer is needed, someone who can bring unity between two extremes. It is logical that a yellow man would be the mediator between black and white. Because God needed such a mediator, he asked me to come to America to heal the rift between white and black. And I'd like to play now a clip from actually from Jim Edgerly. And Jim has done great work. He mentioned it. He's giving lectures, but he's done really great work in the area of US history and America's providential role. So this is the way Jim described it in one of his talks. I'm going to play a short clip for you. And let's see.
The story about America and why it is so important history in history is because this is where those three tribes reconverge and come back together. That's the providential significance of the United States of America. This is the land of tribal reconvergence. This is the new world where Asian Americans, European Americans, and African Americans were all brought together to create a new world. And this is the origin of America's potential for building racial tribal harmony and becoming a prototype nation to learn how this reconvergence can take place over these huge differences over the past 60,000 years. So in this country, we're trying to bring together a culture, create a culture that brings together differences that took place over the last 60,000 years. That is a very, very difficult thing to do. And there's no other country where that's going on. Is there? Brazil is an interesting.
Okay, and another perspective from a young man named John Wood Jr. As part of a great organization called Braver Angels that I will refer to in a few minutes later. And this is the way he described it.
But the reality of the situation is this. The youngness of America, and the reason we need to have some grace and patience for ourselves, lies in the fact that even when you dig down deep beneath the idea of the United States of America as a project of self-governance, it is also a project of forming a family across the bitter divides of philosophical differences and the great chasms in our religious convictions and our geographic places of origin, our various ancestral nationalities, to come to a place where in a deep commitment to freedom, liberty, and justice, but also love and goodwill for one another, we can look at somebody who does not look like us, does not think like us, does not believe like us, and say, that person is an American, that person is my neighbor, that person is my friend, that person is my brother or sister. We are family, e pluribus unum, we are one.
Okay, so if you look at American history, who speaks about this more, right? Probably the most in American history, obviously it's Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And we all know the speech, the famous speech, I Have a Dream in 1963. Well, here's a picture of that speech of Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. at that speech. But this is also significant to the presenters, to us, because this painting was done by Christine's father. And his name was James Edwards. He was an African-American. He was an artist. He was schooled in the arts in Paris. And he incorporated many interracial themes in his work. And I believe he's with us tonight. You know, and I believe he's with us tonight in the work that we're doing. So, let's see. So, yeah, Dr. King talked about the beloved community. He said, but the end is reconciliation. The end is redemption. The end is the creation of the beloved community. It is this type of spirit and this type of love that can transform opposers into friends. It is this type of understanding and goodwill that will transform the deep bloom of the old age into the exuberant gladness of the new age. It is this love which will bring about miracles in the hearts of men. He said in 1956, facing the challenge of a new age. So he also described what it's not. He said, we do not have to look very far to see the pernicious effects of a desegregated society that is not integrated. It leads to physical proximity without spiritual affinity. It gives us a society where men are physically desegregated and spiritually segregated, where elbows are together and hearts are apart. It leaves us with a stagnant equality of sameness rather than a constructive equality of oneness. And he said that in 1962 in a lesser known speech, The Ethical Demands of Integration. So fast forwarding to 2024, we see certain hurdles today. You don't hear much talk about integration, honestly. Certain hurdles, still existing. We made a lot of progress, but still significant hurdles. And just to do a quick summary of a few of them, amongst, some Blacks may feel, you've hurt us for so long, we don't trust, want, or need you. Some may also feel we don't have to fit into your culture in offices and schools, etc. Amongst some whites and some Asians, there may be a response, we are not being treated fairly, such as reverse discrimination. We know about the recent Supreme Court case. Some may also believe that we are being replaced by minorities. I believe this is called replacement theory. Also white nationalism. So given these hurdles, how can we contribute to bringing these three tribes together that Jim spoke of earlier into a more racially integrated culture? Well, let's again turn to some of the words of Father Moon. He was talking about his choice of words. When he came up with the name for our church or our movement, the Holy Spirit Association for Unification of World Christianity in 1953, what he said was, in particular, he said that unification represents my purpose to bring about God's ideal world. Unification is not union. Union is when two things come together. Unification is when two become one. So I think, to me, that brings up the words of Reverend Dr. King, that in a sense, maybe he was referring to union when two things come together, a little bit like desegregation, kind of a physical proximity, but not a real or true integration. But he was saying that we need a unification is when two become one. So what does that mean? Well, in another speech, he described it in more expansive terms. He said, everything that I'm speaking of comes down to one simple word, harmony. The ideal world is not a world of uniformity and regimentation, but a world of harmony in which each person plays a distinctive role. Again, sounds very reminiscent of what Dr. King said. And then, very importantly, he said this, by gathering together people from all races and cultures, we are trying to exchange each other's indestructible elements in order to arm ourselves to overcome any circumstance. All year round, the seed is gathering the elements it needs. Do you white people still have some feeling of separateness from Black or yellow people? Do Black people feel resentment towards whites, even after learning the principle? Unless each of you can draw good elements from others, you cannot survive to grow in the springtime. The whole point is how to create one indestructible seed. That was from the Heart of Reunion, 9/11, 1977. So he was saying that in order for two to become one, there has to be an exchange of elements between both sides, and that we need to draw good elements from each other. So this is a step beyond, of course, just desegregation. And it gets into something truly, it gets into, a sense, true integration. So what can we learn from nature in terms of an exchange of elements? There's so many examples in nature of an exchange of elements. One of my favorite examples is dealing with sodium and chlorine. Now, if you look at the makeup, the molecular makeup of sodium and chlorine, well, first of all, we know that as separate elements, they can be toxic to humans. And when you look at the makeup of it, in the sodium atom, there's one extra electron in the outer shell, and that makes it unstable. And chlorine is missing exactly one electron in its outer shell, which also makes it very unstable. So what happens, there's an exchange where the sodium atom gives the extra electron that it doesn't need to the chlorine atom, which is exactly what it's missing. Then, as you can see on the bottom, it forms an ionic bond, and it's almost like magic happens, right? There's a chemical change, much beyond a physical change, and it turns into NaCl, into salt, which we know is one of the building blocks or one of the necessities for human life. So I think that's a great example, one great example of an exchange of elements within nature. And there's so many examples. You know, you take a walk outside, we may not realize that we're giving the plants and the trees, right, the carbon dioxide that they're missing, that they need to survive and to thrive. And what are they doing? While we're walking, they're giving us the oxygen that we need to live and to survive and to thrive. So how can we use these examples? You know, how can we create, as Dr. Moon and was saying, an exchange of elements in society? Well, there are, groups, I mentioned Braver Angels earlier, that are working today to create greater unity. And one of the things that they work on is finding common ground. So Braver Angels sponsors a conversation in race, and part of their focus is to find common ground between the two sides. But when you look at it, there seems to be a significant limitation in that both sides are only contributing to the whole, you know, one fraction of what they truly can contribute, really only a fraction of what they're able to contribute or what their true potential is. So we can see that this may be a step along the road to something greater, but it's not true integration, right? Where both sides truly come together. In a sense, this is really 2 + 2 = 2 or even less, right? Another example, in a different field, the National Organization for Marriage, we have two interlocking circles. So what we're suggesting is when two become one, it's something different. It's when both sides go beyond just finding common ground, but they actually are complementary to each other. They actually complete each other. And instead of being two squares or two interlocking circles, what are we dealing with? Wow, right? We're dealing with one unified circle, right? We call it a yin-yang, as we all know. And where one side is truly completing the other side, right? One side, again, is providing what the other side is missing, and vice versa. So in a sense, what we're suggesting in terms of true integration is not just finding common ground, but finding higher ground. So this will be the subject of our talk today. This is part one. We'll be also presenting a part two in a future date. And we'll be talking about building a racially integrated culture, as we mentioned. And we'll be focusing on today basically mostly the arts and a little bit of science. And why are we starting with the arts? We're starting with the arts because we know that social change in the past has occurred through or has been led often by the arts, right? And if we're to create a more racially integrated society in the future, truly it has to be led by the arts because the arts open people's hearts. But what we're going to be talking about today are the areas of music, clothing, hair and eyes, food, comedy, and genetics. Actually, the part two will be the food, comedy, and genetics. This is part of a larger presentation that Christina and I have of about 200 slides. Don't worry, we won't be doing 200 slides today. It's a much abbreviated presentation. As you can see by the picture, as Jim was saying, to bring the racial harmony, to bring two sides together is very, very difficult. But this is America's providential role, as he was saying. This is what has to be done. and what we need to create in terms of a future society. Okay, I'd now like to turn it over to my longtime friend and partner in this project, Christine. So I will stop my share and send it over to you.
All right. Did you stop your sharing? I still see it.
You don't see it?
I still see yours.
Oh, okay.
Okay. All righty.
Is it, do you still see it? No, there we go.
No, I got it.
Okay.
Okay, so we decided to start off with music, partially because in the history of America, of course, we have to deal with the issue of slavery. And when the Africans were brought to this country, they had nothing with them. They only had their bodies. And even if everything else is taken away from you, you can still sing, you can still dance. Dance is a little bit more specialized, so we decided to concentrate on music instead. So between the African and the European descended peoples, there are differences in their traditions of music. The African tradition is more focused on rhythm and percussion. Europeans focus on melody and orchestration. In the African tradition, there's something called call and response, which turns up in the African churches as well. And in the European tradition, it's more focused on harmony. Not to say that either one tradition is exclusive or can't do the other, but these are what they're known for. The Africans do most of their passing on of their musical tradition through memorization. In the European tradition, there's a very long history of musical notation going at least back to the early Middle Ages, if not earlier. Africans tend to incorporate improvisation in their musical expressions. Europeans are so interested in structure that if you do not play the score the way it's written, you'll get feedback. Africans have a polyrhythmic tradition, Europeans a monorhythmic tradition. Africans incorporate a lot of syncopation, not that Europeans don't. In European music, there's something called rubato, which is a stretching of the timing of music. The African tradition is focused on the pentatonic scale and the European tradition on the diatonic scale. So I'm going to give you a little bit of musical example here. I'm going to play this video about the Black Keys only.
That's because the slaves didn't come to America with do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. That's somebody else's skit, okay? All they had in their musical scale were those five Black notes. We know it in music as the pentatonic scale. And they built the power and pathos of the Negro spiritual on five notes. When you study music, you also come across what are known as white spirituals. Did you know that? And they are white composers who worked with those that scale. In early America, they used to call this the slave scale. And I'm going to play for you what some musicologists think is the most famous white spiritual built on the slave scale or just the Black notes.
I think you all know what that is, Amazing Grace, and here it is again on the White Keys. And both are nice, both are beautiful, but how about some harmony?
I can't hear you. Can't hear you.
Yeah, I'm going to stop sharing because I think we need the music. It didn't come through here. I'm sorry.
It did work in practice, guys. We tested this. Okay.
Oh my. This is where we have this issue again. Oh my goodness. All right.
You want to play the last one?
Yeah, can you see it?
Yeah, you can play the last one and see if it's better.
Should be. I'm sorry, we're having issues here. Oh, my goodness. Why is it showing? Okay. Spirituals were one of the first Black American forms of music to gain international fame. And the Fisk Jubilee Singers went on European tour in 1873 to rescue their university. Some of their performances brought people to tears, and they were actually helped to form originally by the American Abolitionist Society. So this is already a cooperation between Black and white, but it was the music that actually saved their university. It was very emotional and brought people to tears at many times. So I'm gonna play it.
I'm gonna pray to my spirit. Fools in my heart, I'm gonna pray to my spirit. Fools in my heart, I'm gonna pray to my spirit. Fools in my heart, I'm gonna pray till Jesus comes.
Can't you feel the spirit move?
Can't you feel it moving? Can't you feel it moving? Can't you feel it moving?
I'm gonna shout.
And after spirituals, the next development in Black music was the blues, but it did not gain international fame. It was more just contained in America until much later. The next musical genre that went international was jazz. And here's an example from Ramsey Lewis Trio, The In Crowd. And in jazz, you have the combination of European instruments, such as the piano. You have the double bass in this particular one, and more of the improv tradition in Black music. It's sometimes done with a lot of different types of rhythms. And this is another unified or synthesis of Black and white traditions in America. Right now, other things are more popular, rap, hip hop, and so on, but there is a comeback of jazz as well. Snarky Puppy, founded in 2004, has won a lot of Grammy Awards. And music doesn't stay in one place. There's a lot of jazz right now that's happening in Great Britain. Also within the United States, there's something called crossover music, and that's when different artists, recording groups from different backgrounds and music traditions sing each other's songs or play each other's music. And here we have an example of I Will Always Love You, written by Dolly Parton in 1974 in the country music tradition.
So I'll go, but I know I'll think of you each step of the way.
And in the pop rock tradition from the movie Bodyguard, with a little bit of jazz thrown in, we have Whitney Houston singing the same song.
And I will always love you. I will always love you.
All right.
Wow.
Not to leave out the Asian descended people, we have Yo-Yo Ma and his Silk Road Ensemble playing Heart and Soul. And they're people from 20 different countries, and they all compose and they play together.
Heart and soul, I fell in love with you. Heart and soul, the way a fool would do, madly, because you held me tight and stole a kiss in the night. Heart and soul, I beg to be adored, lost control, and tumbled overboard glad.
Okay. So music speaks to the heart directly, but we also can express our creativity through clothing. Africans came to this country with no clothing and were given European clothing. And the examples here of African clothing that I do have are from a more current time period. The Africans in this country, African descended, first started to reclaim their ancient cultures back in the 60s during the civil rights movement, the Black Power movement, the Black is Beautiful movement, and the hippie movement. And the first thing to become very popular in America was the dashiki, which could be worn by all ages and both sexes. And then later on, people started to actually focus on developing an African style in America. And the synthesis here starts to mix the bold textures and textile colors of African tradition with, here we have the shirt waist style of the 50s, and next to it we have this mermaid dress, but there's no pattern whatsoever. African clothing almost always has patterning. This one is kind of a fantasy on a caftan with a British collar. This is an African textile on a blazer, on a shirt, and on a smoking jacket. Also, we have the exchange of elements between Asian and European, as exemplified here by Hiroki Nakamura. He is born in Japan, but he has gotten a lot of inspiration from American styles as well. And he combines both in his clothing line, which is, by the way, extremely expensive. He lives half of the time in Tokyo and the other half in Los Angeles. Now, the biggest thing that separates the races are skin tone, hair, and the look of our eyes. Most African Americans have what is called type C hair. And in America, since we have so many different races coming together, there's a huge range of hair type in this country, from straight hair, which is basically European, to wavy, to curly, and everything in between. Part of the issue amongst Black Americans at the moment is that their hair is not accepted. It's not acceptable. On the left, you have all kinds of African hairstyles, pre-colonial. But if you see anybody walking down the street with these hairstyles, they probably would stand out as not American. And this is an issue that goes back quite far. I'm going to play this video of this woman who wrote a book called Twisted, The History of Hair. And she's British, but she's talking about things that come up in the American society as well.
From weaves to extensions, jerry curls, curly perms, straight perms, and straighteners, my hair was hidden. It was misunderstood, it was damaged, it was broken, and it was completely unloved. That's not surprising. I never saw anybody with hair like mine. Afro-textured hair was, and in many places is, stigmatized to the point of taboo. But it wasn't always this way. In the mid-1400s, Alvise Cadamosto made two trips to Africa. In his journal, he wrote this about the people in West Africa. Both sexes go barefooted and have no coverings to their heads, and weave and tie their hair, though short, into neat tresses. Neat tresses. Cadamosto's accounts were positive, partially because transatlantic enslavement didn't exist yet. There was no imperative to dehumanize Africans. To European observers, there is no sense of African hair being ugly or inferior.
And in America itself, we've had laws about African textured hair. In Louisiana in 1789, there were the Tinian laws, which said that basically any person of color had to wear a head covering. And this was to allow a separation of class so that people who could pass would no longer be able to pass, for example. Also, in the military, there have been issues about hair styles. One of the things that was important was that you could wear the military caps and so on your hair style, whatever it was. And in 2019, California was the first state to adopt a Crown Act. If you haven't heard about it, there are activists trying to get this enacted throughout all 50 states. Also, there's an issue about white parenting Black children who have the Afro-style hair. This woman started a nonprofit that not only does hair, but she teaches white parents how to do Black hair.
I was inspired to start this organization because I met a transracial adoptive mom. She really just needed help. Now watch my fingers here. She never had an experience working with textured hair before, and the appearance of her girls were not good. I saw the genuine need, not only for her, but for so many other moms who were adopting transracially. There are not a lot of families in the African American community or other races who are adopting. So there does need to be more education about the hair and the cultural aspects of adopting a child of a different race.
And then there was my mother, who probably needed a little help. This is I think it's fifth grade. Anyway, And as a biracial person, it was very hard for me to find stuff to put on my hair. So these are two different companies. Mixed Chicks was the first one I heard about, and they're both mixed. One's from Los Angeles, the other one is from New Jersey. And then more recently, this Dr. Ina Hennigan came out with many ethnicities. And she is biracial herself. And this is a picture of her with her biological three daughters, all of whom have very different hair textures. And she developed this product line so that she didn't have to buy a gazillion different products from different stores and different hair emphasis. Now, Asians also have had issues in America. And I'm going to play this video for you. Dr. Yang is Korean American, born in this country and does plastic surgery. And he used to do eyelid surgery, but he no longer does.
A whopping 20% of all women in South Korea have had cosmetic surgery. In 2014, Asian eyelid surgery, that double eyelid surgery I mentioned earlier, was the fourth most popular plastic surgery across the world. In Asians, it was number one. So what started the boom in plastic surgery amongst East Asians? Although double eyelid surgery was first introduced back in Japan in the 19th century, it was only after the Korean War that Asian eyelid surgery and Asian plastic surgery in general became really, really popular. Now, approximately 50% of East Asians have a double crease, a natural crease of their upper eyelid. The other 50% have monolids.
Okay. And then why was this so popular? There's another excerpt from his.
Dr. Millard was stationed in South Korea during the Korean War in the 1950s. And at that time, he was performing reconstructive plastic surgery on soldiers who had been injured and cosmetic plastic surgery on Korean women. Yes, you heard that right. Reconstructive surgery on soldiers and cosmetic surgery on Korean women. Now, among the first people to undergo Asian eyelid surgery, where we create an extra crease in a patient with a monolid, were the Korean brides of the soldiers back during the Korean War. The War Brides Act of 1945 allowed American soldiers to bring home wives from the different countries that they may have been stationed at overseas. And this was even though interracial marriages were banned throughout parts of the country until the landmark case Loving versus Virginia back in the 1960s.
Okay.
Dr. Millard was stationed in South Korea during the.
There we go.
We have 1 minute.
Okay. So I'm going to play this one little video, which is a couple of seconds, but I think it says something important.
Does the way I wear my hair make me a better person? Does the way I wear my hair make me a better friend? Does the way I wear my hair determine my integrity?
And just as a final note, going back to what was in the previous video, my parents got married in 1956. And at that time, there were only 10 states in the country that allowed interracial marriage. And I didn't know that growing up. I had no idea. But I think the point of my bringing all these things to your attention is that I do not agree with political correctness, but I do believe we should be spiritually sensitive to other people's backgrounds, and especially people who do not look the way we look. And that is it. Okay, so that is the end of part one. I am sorry for the technical difficulties.
You're muted, Jim.
There we go.
Thank you, Christine. Thank you.
You're welcome.
You're a living example. It seems like our respondent, Reverend. By the way, Jeffrey, would you like to say anything, add anything to Christine's area or vice versa before we go to our next step? You're muted.
I'm mute.
Yeah, I don't have anything in particular because we were right on the clock there, right? So we actually ended exactly. We cut everything down, so we could end exactly there.
Okay.
But you know, I just think Christine, you know, we're bringing up the point of that America's providential role is as you mentioned, Jim, is to create the racially integrated society. And I think a big part of that is the exchange of elements, right? Where two or three or et cetera can become one, where actually we can complete each other, fill in what each other's missing, and create something potentially greater, right? That's our challenge, right? To create, not just in the arts, it starts with the arts, but how do we apply that to economics? How do we apply that to politics? How do we apply it to the other areas of life? Where we could so benefit from bringing our perspectives together, right? To create something that could be, you know, much greater as opposed to being apart. Mm-hmm. I think that's, you know, the essence really of what we're trying to say. So, yeah.
And I just want to add that our list of topics includes painting, sculpture, architecture,
yes,
business, poetry, literature, movies, which we didn't go into today. We'd be here all for weeks.
let me just say that Christine has done a tremendous amount of research. I mean, she all these different areas of art and architecture and dance.
Dance is my background. I know that part.
Right. So in the whole presentation, we're showing how the pieces, right? The European style, the African style, you know, and Asian style, and how we bring them together in the specific ways and specific examples in the different fields, these different fields. And thanks to Christine, we were able to put a lot of this together, over a pretty long period of time. But yeah.
A couple years.
Yes, Christine, you went to school in these very areas, right? Is that my understanding?
I have a split degree in dance and fine art.
Dance and fine art. Oh, boy. And you're married.
And my dad was a painter, so, and I paint as well.
And your husband is a musician.
Yes.
Okay. Well, it seems that our respondent, Reverend Oliver, I don't think he was able to join the meeting. As I mentioned, he's in Zambia. It's 2 o'clock in the morning there. Ooh. And or 3 o'clock. So it might be, Stephen, do you see Reverend Oliver on the participant list at the very bottom? His first name is Zagery. So it'd be the last one.
He's not with us, unfortunately. Sorry.
Okay. Very good. I'm sorry he couldn't, but it's perfectly understandable. Well, I wonder if I see some of his, his group is with us, but I don't want to call on anybody without giving them forewarning. So I think it's probably a good time for us to begin the discussion. We have a good 30 minutes available if we can use it to follow up on the presentation given by Christine and Jeffrey. Thank you everyone for joining us. And now remember, this is part one. And in part two, we're going to hear about dance.
No. Clothing, food, comedy, and Jeff, you're muted.
What about dance?
We took that out because it's also all videos and there are not so many people who are, I mean, I find it interesting, personally.
Well, we'll talk about this.
We'll talk about it.
Okay, how about a third part? Then I'll put it back in.
Okay, so, but I would hope you can join us for part two. And remember that the HJI conference begins on, that I hope we'll all join into. It has seven really interesting sessions, eight sessions. It's a Zoom conference from April in the evenings, mornings and evenings, April 11th, 12th, and 13th. Thank you, everyone.